He's the first batch in IRMA. After IRMA, he worked in the area of rural development with cooperatives in association with the National Dairy Development Board. He has been a consultant to voluntary agencies and to the National Wastelands Development Board. His further assignments include the post of National Director Oxfam, UK and India, Program Director, South Asia Plan International, and Executive Director, Charities Aid Foundation. He founded Charities Aid Foundation in India, Credibility Alliance, a network for accountability and resource alliance, and founded the Human Rights Network. He is Amicus Curiae to the Supreme Court in the elder rights matter for pensions, homes, and the maintenance law, which has helped bring elder issues to the forefront. He currently serves full-time as Chief Executive Officer of HelpAge India and serves on the international boards of HelpAge International and GuideStar International. Please welcome Sri Mathew Cherian.
Namaskar, Vanakkam, Sat Sri Akal, and good afternoon. I'm glad to be here, and I'd like to thank first and foremost the director for inviting me to speak to you all. I came here 8 years ago, invited by the students to speak at the Milap function that you held here. So I am once again on the campus. So, of course, when we studied, we were the guinea pigs, and we studied in an animal diagnostic laboratory, which was part of NDDB. It was across the road, and so we were the first guinea pigs. So you can see the guinea pig now after 39 years, sorry, I think, yeah. So, and in the 40 years, I've learned quite a lot. Of course, IRMA also tried to teach us. And to be frank, when we were taught, the professors also were experimenting with the teaching curriculum. Subhash Sharma, who taught us Manak, and somebody taught teacher, now he has started talking that we have to learn from spiritualism management. So I met him 2 weeks ago because he had invited me to his institute to speak at the Indus Business Academy. And I said, if you look at spirituality, then you won't learn management. So that is how I want to learn. And actually, I would like to say that we learned a lot from our own peer students. I've learned as much from Sodi, Vivekanand, Ravi Nigam, and also I would like to remember Mr. Sanjoy Ghosh from the first batch. And we were very dear friends. And we worked in Rajasthan on the drought in 1986. And then I also worked in Majuli with him in Assam. And I was with him the day before he was killed. And here was a person who was so dedicated that he was even prepared to give up his life for the cause. So that was the motivation. So I would consider him, actually, he celebrated his birthday about 7 days ago, 60th birthday, and I'm sure he's also amongst us somewhere. So I would like to pay my tribute to him. I've learned a lot with him. So comes the first lesson, which I, of course, learned from Sanjoy, was identify yourself with the poor, the dispossessed, the marginalized, and various kinds of stakeholders. The difference between professional management, as taught in the IIMs, and the rural management is, our owners are not the business owners. They are the people. So we have what is known as, IRMA is basically a bottom-up management. So Sodhi's boss is the millions of farmers are the bosses. For me at HelpAge, the millions of elderly whom I serve are the bosses. So it is not, we have to serve them rather than serve the owners of the business. So that is a fundamental difference, and this is where you will have to, all of you have to identify with the poor. So identification is the first important lesson that I learned. And then it is also appropriate that we also look at the other aspects which is required. When we were studying in IRMA, on one fine day, we had an incident which even now stays in my mind. The director of the IT division was asked to leave the campus in 24 hours. I believe there was a case of integrity, and he had committed some kind of corrupt act which was discovered by Dr. Cherian, and he packed him out of the campus in 24 hours. Yesterday when I met Sodhi also had to pack up a staff of GCMMF who had committed some misdemeanor. And of course, Sodhi improved on Dr. K's track record. He sent him off in 4 hours. So, congratulations to you. And that is where my second lesson comes, that you have to have integrity when you work, and there should be no case of dishonesty within the organization that you run. And there should be a zero tolerance for it. If you have a zero tolerance for it, you will succeed. And this is where all of you as future rural managers have to watch out. Whatever field you work, whether you work in a corporate or whether you work in a NGO or in a cooperative. So this is something which I learned from IRMA, and it has stayed with me throughout my life. So when we have to look at the, when you look around us, we see a lot of problems. In fact, I try to stay, at least even now, I stay for 1 week in villages or in the areas that we work. Because HelpAge treats about 1.5 million elderly across India. And we have a large medical team, and we have many doctors with us, and so we are treating older people who are neglected, who are not able to reach out to hospitals, and so our doctors go and treat. And because of our large treatment base, we were declared as the largest mobile medical service in South Asia by the list of so we continue to win awards. But at the same time, I would like you people to also think about how can we become more and more accountable? How can our services become accountable to the people whom we serve? So whether you have a medical van or whether you are doing a livelihood program, how can we reach the last person and how can we learn from them? It is better that we learn from our farmers, we learn from our people rather than, of course, IRMA will teach you a lot of knowledge. But I think life is completely continuous learning, and you've got to learn from these people. And that is why I spend about a week. Of course, the director says that I'm traveling all the time. Actually, I travel because this is where I enjoy being with people, and that is what I do. So this is something which you need to look at. Now, of course, the world is going through a great crisis. Last year, I was nominated by the World Economic Forum to be on the Global Future Council. The Global Future Council is, of course, they meet at Davos once a year, but actually we contemplate what are the issues facing the future. And we are like forecasters for the world. So actually we find two major aspects that is going to trouble the whole world. One is climate change, and the other one is aging. Most of the people in this room will live to be 100 years, at least. So that is the longevity revolution which is happening. The other is the fourth industrial revolution, which is internet technology, mobile technology, and all this, is going to take you to a different place. But what is going to happen is, my elderly will be left out of this digital revolution. If you've got grandfathers at home, you will know that they can't operate your smartphone. So they have been left out of it. So we have, as a human being on this earth, we have an individual responsibility. So each one of you have an individual responsibility before you have a universal responsibility. And your individual responsibility is to your family, is to your community, and to your society. And if you can do actions which will reduce climate change, like reduce your own water intake, reduce your own smoke intake, if you want to buy your second car, hesitate to buy your second car, if you try to pollute less, you have to do it. This is first your responsibility. I heard the Vice President also say there is an individual responsibility which all of you have. Before you can accuse people for corporate responsibility and this, we have to see that we have to live this world so that our children's children can also look after them. So it is not enough that you deplete the resources and then hope that somebody else will replace it. So this responsibility, all of you as rural managers have an individual responsibility. And what I have learnt is, there's a lot of talk these days on strategies and how to build up strategic plans, etc. And my belief has been, don't invest too much time on strategies itself. In your organization, invest in people. And people are your best bet. If you can invest in people and help them to grow, the organization will also grow. And that is how leaders like you can build up an organization. Because in the future, people are your best bet. And there is also, as you people as coming out of IRMA, I think some of you may have done your campus interviews and you must be wondering, like Alice in Wonderland, which way to go. And I would say, like the cat in Alice in Wonderland, you can go as far as you want, provided you go long enough. So that you will reach your destination. And but you will have to set yourself in life, what is your life's purpose, what do you want to do, and you will have to set yourself certain goals which you can measure for yourself. And it doesn't matter where the choice is, whether it is in, I would not distinguish between corporates, NGOs, cooperatives, etc. But you have yourself an own purpose and see that wherever you go, you can be an agent of transformation. And if you can do that, then life will do you good as well. So this is something which I have learned over the years. And then coming to my field of aging, my advice to many of you is, we have this Matrudeva Bhava, Pitrudeva Bhava, Gurudeva Bhava, Atithi Deva Bhava. And this is all of you as children. You have your first responsibility to your mother, and then to your father, and then to the teachers, the gurus who taught you, like Hitesh Bhai is here, Tushar Bhai was in the morning. All these gurus also you got to respect and take care of them. And of course, Atithis, guests like me will come and go. When you are here, you will give me the respect, and after I go, you can forget us for a time being. So this is what you will have to do. Because India's biggest problem is children are not looking after the parents. And last week, of course, I was involved with introducing a bill in Parliament which is called the Maintenance of Parents Bill, which says if you do not look after your parents and if the parent complains, then you can go to court and the court will order maintenance. So I'm sorry to say that India, which prided in the family, has come to such a pass. But day in and day out, I'm seeing this story repeat across. It is not that North Indians are abusing and South Indians are not abusing. We have found in our studies that elder abuse is rampant across the country. And one in four people, older people across the country, say they feel abused at home. And the abuser is the son. of course, followed by the daughter-in-law, and then by the daughter also in some cases. Of course, Ekta Kapoor has made a fortune with the Saas Bahu tales, but I think it is a gender bias in society which is causing this, and usually it is the son who is abusive, but to the outside world they say that the Bahu is abusive. So this is the problem in our society. So how can we, so my message to all of you is, at least when you grow up, please look after your parents. You won't require people like HelpAge to look after them. So that is what I would like you to say. And so what you need to look at is, how will you discover your own life? And these are the learnings which I learned over a period of time. And it is something that you can use in your personal life. And so that when you are no more, people will remember you for your relationships. And this is an area which I have learned in my work in aging. There are three simple facts if you want to live long and prosper. The three important factors is, the first is the food. And if you can eat food in moderation, you can live long. If you eat too much, you will suffer from non-communicable diseases, hypertension, diabetes, the whole works. And then you can keep eating as much tablets as you eat food. So then, but still you will not live long. So there is an issue behind it. The second is exercise. I do not know how many people do exercise in the morning, because this morning I walked out in this campus, I did my morning walk. Of course, I saw a lot of professors walking, but I didn't see any students walking. So I will infer that you are couch potatoes and you want to wake up late. But mark my words, that when you grow up, you will have to do a 1 hour of exercise every day if you want to live long and prosper. And the third area is, how do you maintain your connections? How do you maintain your social connections? Actually, in old age, that's going to be the biggest problem which is going to face Indian society. Children will leave you, and you will be left with your spouse. And all women in India live longer than men. Okay, so the longevity dividend is much higher for women, because women are the more genetically stronger species. Men are the weaker species, so they will die first. So the women will live lonely existence as a widower. So build up your social connections. And if you build up your social connections, then you will live long and prosper. So this is something which you eat food in moderation, exercise a lot, and build up your social connections. If you can do all three of it, you will live long and prosper. May HelpAge in its, may IRMA in its 40th year prosper. And Hitesh Bhai, I hope we can contribute. I think somebody said universities stay for 1,100 years. So may you live long and prosper, and may the institute also live long.